Hello everyone, Treecks here, and welcome back to Donkey Kong Land 2. Last time we got started on World 2 and 3, because yes, in this game World 2 and 3 compared to Donkey Kong Country 2 are the same world for some reason. We don't have to go back to the previous levels to show off the warp barrels, because unlike what I thought in the first part, the second world actually doesn't have any warp barrels. I always get confused by that, because of Donkey Kong Country 2 does have warp barrels in the first two worlds, but in this game it's only in the first world, so... But anyway, speaking of World 2, we're pretty much nearing the end of that, because Squawk's Shaft, just like in the original, is one of the final levels there. So let's go do that one quickly. If I remember correctly, this one is pretty easy to find everything, so... don't really have to worry too much about stuff here. And the challenges in the level are pretty much the same as they are in Donkey Kong Country 2. We start off with a little bit of a barrel section. First one to go left, by the way, because we can see a barrel pointing to the left there. Pretty obvious, and this is where both the K and the first bonus barrel are. But anyway, like I said, gimmick-wise, this one is pretty similar to its original. We start off with a little bit of a barrel section until the checkpoint, and then Squawks comes into play, hence the name of the level. But it isn't an entire Squawks level, so... with that, it is pretty much the same as it is in Donkey Kong Country 2. So... okay, now that we're put out here, we can go up here and immediately start going for the hero coin, which is down here. It's pretty hard to find because of not having any indication or something down here. But there is. If you bother going left, you will find a little platform, which houses the hero coin for this level. Okay, for all the other stuff, we don't have to worry about that until the Squawk section. I believe only the O appears before the checkpoint. But I'm also pretty sure that one's in plain sight. This is nothing, I believe, just for a couple of bananas. There is a little bit of a barrel section here to the left, as you can see. Oh, oops. Didn't want to go there, but... okay, as long as I live. Okay, I need to get used to the barrel timing here again. It's also something that sometimes trips me up a little bit in Donkey Kong Country games. Timing for blasting out of barrels is not always the same. Sometimes there's a little bit of a delay, like in this game. It's the same delay that's also present in Donkey Kong Country 3. Get Yo's over here. Like I said, in plain sight, because the hook is clearly visible, so... don't have to worry about that all too much. Yeah, about the timing of the barrels. Sometimes, like in Donkey Kong Country 1, for instance, and Donkey Kong Country 2, you have this... okay? I'm pretty sure I jumped. Apparently too late. Okay, let's try that again. But it does give a little bit of an example about how vertical scrolling works in this game. As you can see, even though this is a vertical level, if you fall down, you don't necessarily just fall down a couple of platforms. You actually fall faster than the camera. And therefore, if you lose sight of the camera, you still die. Counts as a death. Interesting. But anyway, we have Squawks now. We are back on our feet, you might say. We've turned our feet into wings. Squawks works precisely the same as he does in the original, so nothing new about that. Although I must admit, his controls are a little bit stiff, so I always have a lot of trouble flying around with him in the Donkey Kong Land games. This applies to both Donkey Kong Land 2 and 3. For some reason, his controls aren't very well designed, I feel. So I usually have a lot of trouble flying around with him. But okay, when it comes to finding stuff in this area, you pretty much want to hang left at first until you find the end, which I already did. And then after that you are going to want to stay on the right, because the final bonus barrel and the G are both on the right side of whatever opening you're in. So whenever you go to the next section, you might say, go right immediately, because as you can see, to the right is where they hide the good stuff. After the end, at least, because the end is the only one on the left, and after that, the rest is on the right. Okay, this is a simple get rid of all of the zingers. Just nothing we have not done before, so shouldn't be a problem. Okay, next up G, and then we should have everything. It's also on the right. Yeah, whenever stuff is easy to remember, I tend to remember. I only remember the stuff that is easy to remember. But okay, this final cannon is here trying to make life miserable for us, but he's not able to. End of stage, please. Okay, before we move on to the world 3 section of the world, we find a funky flight, but we're not going to care about him. We're going to care about Barrel Bayou, the first world 3 level, which in this game is still in world 2. Once again, still not too sure why, but it is what it is. Bonus barrel to the left immediately, by the way. And this is the kind of barrel you need to steer yourself, just like in the original game. Barrel Bayou introduces us to the manual control barrels. And I must admit, here on the Super Game Boy / Game Boy Color version of this game, these swamp levels were actually colored in lime green, as you can see, and I really like the aesthetic of that. It really feels neat here. It really reminds you of the original Game Boy screen, which also has this lime green color scheme, of course, instead of the regular black and white that you see in the emulated versions of the Game Boy. Whenever playing on an actual original fat white Game Boy, you know the ones I mean, actually also use these lime green and black color schemes, of course, and this one really reminds me of it. I should learn how to jump in time, apparently, because that's already the second time that happened today. For some reason, I'm suddenly in a hurry. Okay, that was awesome. That clobber following me around. But okay, let's remember whenever we do some platforming to actually jump in time. Because if you don't jump in time, you actually fall into the abyss. Might come as a surprise to you, but don't jumping in time actually kills you. Okay, yeah, we see a barrel up here. You can ignore this one, because this one's actually a shortcut for some reason, but if you want to stuff, you want to go to the bottom path, because the O is here. If you take the top path, you will fall out of this barrel over here. Nothing too special about that. And you skip the O if you go that way, so please don't. We all know the O is a legendary Kong letter in this game. Okay, just like in the original level, we have a Rambi section at some point here. And for some reason we get the checkpoint after that. Feels weird. Okay, once again, choose your poison. We can go up or we can go down. In this case we want to go down, because if you go up you will only find a couple of bananas. If you go down you will find a hero coin. So, I think I know what the best idea is. You don't have to worry about the end. It's actually not in this section, so we will find that later. Okay, that was it already for the Rambi section. Not really sure why it was there, because he had absolutely nothing to do when it comes to practical use. Okay, here we find the cannonball for the second bonus. The moment you find this cannonball, you realize you don't have to worry. You don't have to look for a cannon, or a barrel, I mean. You do have to look for a cannon. It is our second bonus. Okay, and it gives us a squitter section. Normally I'm a very big fan of using Squitter. I really like his moveset, the way he works with his webs, but in... Oh, you get the N automatically. But yeah, like I explained in the previous part, in Donkey Kong Land series, because of having to use the select button in order to use his web platforms, and the fact that you can only have one up at a time instead of two in the Donkey Kong Country games where he's used, I like him a lot less in the Donkey Kong Land games, not gonna lie. He's way better in the country games, because of having better controls. Using the A button, which is right beside the jump button, making it easier. And the fact that you can use more platforms also makes it easier. The squitter in these games are a big downgrade, not gonna lie. Yeah, got everything. I always get paranoid for stuff like that. Glimmer's Galleon, though. You might remember this this level from the original game, and how Glimmer is following us around with his light, the blinding light. Guess what? That is impossible to do in a Game Boy game. Memory limitations don't allow that. So they solved it like this. we actually have barrels here in the water, which actually light up the room for a few moments. We want to go right first. The level goes to the left, by the way, but first we want to go right, because there's a couple of things to the right. Namely the K, and if you go even further right, we find a bonus barrel. Pretty much comparable to the original level too, because the original level also gave us a bonus barrel right at the start, going in the opposite direction of where the level takes you normally. This is just collect the stars, and it's not even in the dark, so not really sure where the challenge is here. It is what we're going to have to work with. Number 15. Still no use for the creme coins we have seen, unlike in the original game. But trust me, we will use them at some point. Just a lot later than we would do in the original game. Okay, and guards of course also going to be present. Every single water level in every Donkey Kong Country game always has an handguard. Sacred rule. But the fact that this level actually makes use of barrels to light up the room instead of having an animal body following us around. That really reminds me of Loopy Lights, a level from the original Donkey Kong Country. Which also makes use of a dark level and barrels to light up the room. That's basically the idea that this level uses, to replace Glimmer. Because, yeah, kinda unable to implement him in a Game Boy game. That wouldn't have worked out. And just like in the previous water levels, there's tons of invisible pathways. You can go through the walls and stuff like that to find Kong letters, hero coins. That's always what I think is really annoying about these water levels. They do that a lot better in Donkey Kong Land 3. The water levels there I actually really like a lot more. Those really remind me of the water levels from Donkey Kong Land 1. A lot more similar to the ones there. The underwater levels in this game are always based on these inside of the pirate ships, and they all look the same and all have this tendency to have invisible pathways going through walls and stuff like that. Never really been a big fan of that. I'm pretty sure I already talked about that in previous water level we met. You even get multiple N-guard barrels now. I was already on guard, and still game gives us another barrel. Game is over exaggerating. But still, it's usually still not really that big of a problem to find everything in these kinds of levels, because it's just a matter of whenever you see some kind of a niche, you can easily hug the walls and quickly find out if there is an invisible pathway there or not. And of course, having played these levels before in my life also helps, so I kinda know when to expect some secrets. Usually I'm not able to remember where they are exactly, but I do know kind of when they are coming up, so usually I'm able to find them. Even though I did miss one of the bonuses in the previous water levels. The last one is actually really close to the end, over here I think. There's actually a point where we can go through the right wall. Apparently not here, but I do know that it's coming up, and that's actually where the final bonus is. Should be down here somewhere, because we are closing in on the end, so... Yeah, here we go. This should be it. Yeah, let's see where this leads to. Yeah, there we are. Like I said, I kinda remembered where it was, but still had to pinpoint the exact location a little bit. But this is the final thing we need, excluding the Kong letters, which are of course not required officially. So if I happen to miss one of those, I'm not gonna care. I will try to get all of the Kong letters on all levels, but I don't necessarily have to. Well, in this case, we are done completely. So, Croquette Clamber is up next, we still have some time, so let's do this one too. Returning to the beautiful lime green of the original Game Boy. Because of course this is technically an original Game Boy game. Donkey Kong Land 3 actually is the first game to release on the Game Boy Color, even though only the original version, the Japanese version. For some reason the Western localization did release on the Game Boy. But don't worry, whenever I start playing Donkey Kong Land 3, whenever that Let's Play comes up, I will of course play the Game Boy Color version. I have a way to work around that, the fact that only the original released on the Game Boy Color. I have a workaround for that. I of course will still play it on the most modern system, which is the Game Boy Color in that game's case. Oops! I have a tendency to have a wrong timing with my barrel blasting and yet still live. But this was only a bonus, so if I failed, I simply would have been able to try again. You usually don't get thrown out of the bonus too far away from the bonus, so it's usually pretty easy to re-enter the bonus the moment you fail them. I don't think it happens too often that the exit of a bonus is really far away from the entrance to a bonus. And unlike in the Donkey Kong Country Returns series, you actually can retry bonuses over and over again in the early eras of the Donkey Kong Country games. It isn't until Donkey Kong Country Returns where they come up with the silly idea that whenever you fail a bonus, you have to restart the entire level before you can try again. And yeah, I'm paranoid for stuff to the left, because I know there's something coming up to the left at some point. Once again, I'm not exactly too sure which one is going to be the one. But one of these sticks pointing out of the water... Oh, I think I found it. That was what I was looking for. It was in clear sight, apparently. But yeah, I remembered there was a hero coin to the left of one of those... whatever you call it. Okay, we've got all the Kong letters already. For some reason, these swamp levels, because of being so horizontally designed, there's not really too much vertical scroll in these levels. Because of that, they're usually pretty easy to maneuver, I think. And platforming-wise, they're also not really that terrible. So, there we go. That was really quick. I even have time for one more level. Let's do Rattle Battle. One of my favorite levels in the original Donkey Kong Country 2. Let's see how well they made the level this time around. First things first, secret immediately at the start. And it was only bananas. Okay, I remembered something else there. Don't you jump as high as me. I'm the only reptile who's allowed to jump high. Okay, let's get off sync with this guy because we're getting nowhere. Stupid crocodile thinks he can jump as high as a snake. Let's translate that to real life. Have you ever met a snake that can jump? Or even a crocodile that can jump? It's not uncommon for reptiles to jump, but usually it's only lizards and... crocodiles and snakes you usually don't see that doing. They are good climbers though, but jumping? No. Video game logic at its best. Anyway, let's talk about the level now. Just like in the original, we are transformed into Rattly, and we have to play this entire level as Rattly, trying to find stuff, like bonuses that are hidden up high. And this one's pretty easy. We jump up high until we get hit by a Zinger that is placed in a very tricky location. Okay, let's try that again. Bam. Like I said, you never get thrown too far out of a bonus, so it's usually easy to retry. This time, remember, they actually place zingers above us. Let's steer a little bit more carefully. And success. Yeah, let's move on. It's the only bonus in this level, so luckily we don't have to worry about that anymore. Oh. Apparently that still counted. That's actually really tricky about these levels. Some of these kaboings, I believe they're called, the jumping kremlings. Sometimes they actually jump into the screen so fast that you can't really react to them. The moment you are moving towards the right, they come out of nowhere. And before you have time to react, they're already touching you. It can be pretty scary in a level like this. The kaboings that come out of nowhere. Yeah, like this guy. Yeah, this one did hit me, but that does give a good example of what I mean. You're just droning along to the right, because you have to, the level goes to the right, so of course you're going right, and then all of a sudden an enemy goes to the left at high speed. That can be so annoying. But I can imagine Rare programming it like, get hit by the same guy. Okay, let's try to do this a little bit more carefully, because I'm getting destroyed now. Just remember, every single corner in this little level can house something that can suddenly kill me. Okay, that was a bad bad idea. Oh! Okay, let's see if our high jump can save us. Ooh! Yeah, apparently you can do that. Okay. Still alive. Okay, G. Oh, come on! It's no longer funny, game. Okay, we're here. However, stuff to the right of the goal. Nothing too special, just a coin and some bananas. But anyway, that was it. And for slime climb, I'm going to do that one next time. 21 minutes is more than enough for one episode. We cleared level 2 and we started on level 3. Yes, I'm still calling it level 2 and 3. I'm translating this to the original game. But officially, it's world 2. And we still have slime climb to do, but that will be next time. So, thanks for watching and see you next time when we continue. Treecks out.